In this. We have a common sense notion, particularly in the West, that perception operates something like this. This is another picture from their book. I'm going to show you several. You may or may not be able to make that out very well. Don't worry. Don't worry about the words. I just jocked the page of the book last night so you could see it as one of the pictures. Here's our common sense notion of perception, our, if you will, mental model. The world's out there, we're over here. We don't see it perfectly. It's very complex. There's a lot going on. We filter it. We abstract it. It goes through various kinds of processing. What is it that characterizes good perception from that standpoint?
Clear filter.
Clear filter. Thank you. Seeing it more and more as it is. What's really going on? Is that right? I don't know about you, but since I was about 7 years old, I've been stumped by the meaning of that question. Maybe I can't figure out what that question means. Is that right? But I think it means something like this. I think in its common sort of linguistic construction, it means something like this. There is an external reality, and is what you're saying consistent with that external reality? Now, I'd like to tell you that whole epistemology, to use a fancy word, is based upon an assumption. Two assumptions, actually. One is that there is an external reality, and two, that we could ever, ever, ever say anything intelligent about its intrinsic nature. Now, I'm not saying that's assumptions to say they're wrong. I'm just saying they're assumptions. Because to say they're wrong would be to say I know what's right. You're beginning to get an idea of where we're headed. This is the common sense view of perception. There's an eagle out there. This little thing here is an eagle. That's the external reality. And then it comes in. This is a bunch of film, like going through a film. And it goes through in the eye, you know, and all these signals go on in the eye and eventually comes back. And up here is this little cute little guy. You can't see all the details. There's a cute little picture here. It's a cute little guy who's taking the film and he's projecting it onto an image so it can be seen. And there's another little guy up here madly typing at a keyboard who's typing out the word eagle. In other words, this signal is somehow being processed and made into an abstraction called eagle. And then there's this wire that goes down here and goes down to this looks like a pipe organ out of which the voice says, eagle. There's only a couple of problems with this common sense notion of perception. First is, it's rooted in assumptions. So at least we should be cognizant of the fact that it's rooted in assumptions. And the second is, if there is any progress occurring in this field of understanding the biology of perception, it's an untenable viewpoint. I'd like to read you something from the very end of this book. This is last chapter. They're summarizing their argument. In effect, if we presuppose the existence of an objective world independent of us as observers and accessible to our knowledge through our nervous system, we cannot understand how our nervous system functions in its structural dynamics. Don't get me wrong. None of that says there is no external reality. I just said there's two assumptions. One is that there is an external reality, and two is we can never say anything intelligent about its intrinsic nature. I'm not saying that neither of those assumptions are wrong. Couldn't say they're wrong. They'll contradict sort of the premise I'm inviting us to consider. But there's an interesting body of thinking emerging that what we're understanding about the biology of cognition and perception suggests that we can't reconcile what we're understanding with the basic assumptions, those two assumptions. I'd like to do a little experiment with you because we have to move this out of the abstract domain of my talking on a very high level here and you trying to make some sense of it. And we run a little experiment. John, I'd like to play that first piece of music. Tell me some of the things you heard. What's the most front of your mind thing you heard? Da 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 da. A reoccurring pattern. Okay? I'm going to play it again now. This time I want you to hear the shadow pattern. Because that pattern always is matched by something. There's a shadow to it. It's not just an object, there's an object and a shadow. Like you listen to both. Ready to go? What did you hear that time? Did you hear some other things going on beside the da 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 da? Did you? Okay. I'm going to play it one or two more times. I'm going to keep at this for a couple times. I'm going to ask you just to keep thinking about some different things. Very simple. On this pass, listen to the different families of instruments. Let's hear the different families. Keep going, John. You start to hear more of them? Did you hear the percussion there? It's very critical at a certain point. It gives a totally different tone and sort of emotional quality to it. I'm going to play it now one more time, just a little bit longer. Listen for the intensity. Listen now for the intensity. How it works. So, what are you noticing? Did you notice changes to the different plays? I see a lot of people nodding their heads. Just any few comments on that. What are some of the things you started to notice differently? When it's in the minor keys, it's very intense. It moves into a major key and resolves. That's obviously a fairly sophisticated perception. What? See, she brought into play something beyond what I had even suggested. What's that she brought into play? She brought in a different distinction. Different distinction between major keys and minor keys. As a result, and the tension, which was somewhat similar to the intensity which I asked you to consider. You see, as a result of that, what happened for her? As a result of having that distinction between major keys and minor keys, what was she able to do? She appreciated it more deeply. She saw something we didn't see. I'll put it another way. She heard something that most of us didn't hear. Think about it. Somebody else had their hand up. Do you want to say? Yeah.
I was going to say, without that knowledge, something we could know, or what I would feel, would be that at times it's darker.
Right.
At times it's lighter.
Right.
Now we don't know what she knows.
Now, what has this gentleman just done? He's invoked another distinction. A distinction which has some similarity to your distinction, but it doesn't require much music, now theory, knowledge to invoke. But that distinction as well, absent that distinction, you wouldn't be able to see the lighter and the darker. See, that distinction allowed you to see the lighter and the darker. Right? Moving between distinctions between different representational systems, auditory and visual. Light and dark is a visual metaphor. So he invoked a different distinction which broadened. You can almost like close your eyes and see colors. Remember the wonderful Disney movie, Fantasia? They did that. Let you listen to the music and see the colors. Invoked a new set of distinctions.
But is the perception the same?
Is the perception the same? The man in front said, but isn't the perception the same? Well, I ask you. I'm not saying there's an answer. Think about it. Do we hear with our ears? Or do we hear with our distinctions?
I was just going to check that the knowing what we heard or saw or felt, and then being able to articulate it, because what I heard that lady do is articulate for me and resonate.
Right.
Something I couldn't have articulated.
Right.
I didn't have
a mind. You were talking now about what Matran and Varela call a linguistic domain. We've begun to share a linguistic domain where something now, what one person perceives, can influence others through the sharing of linguistic distinctions. Now, we're not going to get too technical about this. I want to stay sort of at the real fundamentals here. The real core question here is, do we hear with our ears? Do we really see with our eyes? Or is there something intrinsic in the distinctions that we hold?
Peter, each time you played it for us and you asked us to listen a little differently, the music sounded different. The underlying music was the same, but each time, at least for me, each time I listened to it, it never sounded the same because I was focusing on a different thing.
I'm with you. Can you hear Larry in front, Don in front? He said, each time I asked him a different question, the music sounded differently. That's what he said. They said something else, which technically is a little inaccurate. I'm going to pick on him. He's a friend. I can do this. He said, the music was the same. That's an assumption. Thank you.